persona. I always showed that I was not a kid who, you know, who got in trouble. So I didn't choose to hustle. I went to the prison for selling drugs. Never took anything that didn't belong to me, but that's how I was raised. Never lied to my mom, so my mom would ask the tough questions. You know what I mean? I lost my mom on May 16th when I was in Bentonville, South Carolina. I left, well, after Billy went home, Pastor, what we call the Billy inside. We call him the gun line inside. I can tell you, I was somebody on the street and I was somebody while I was in prison. Meaning that whatever I said, I did, good or bad, it's nothing to brag about, it's just who I was. So I was always the person that gave my word, and he can tell you that. So when he invited me, I was honored because he thought enough to invite me.
Amen.
But he's the same person now that he was inside.
Amen.
I went to church with him inside. You know, I was, for better understanding, I was a spokesperson a long time for a lot of guys from Mississippi. Well, all the guys from Mississippi. Mm-hmm. So whatever I said, they had to do. But I always saw God's direction.
Amen.
And leading my people.
Amen.
I didn't let the flesh lead me because I wanted kids. I always try to transform young minds so that they would never come back to prison.
Amen.
Some listen, some didn't. I got a sack under 1 week. A guy from Yazoo City, 20 years old, had been down since January 24th of last year. He hung himself. He was supposed to go home next month. They put him in the shoe and he hung himself. You might see it. I got it on my phone. I'll show it to either one of y'all. Rock Nation's fan from the Forest Family film. Because they think it was foul play. No, but he succumbed to the pressures of prison. Prison, you know, people, guys come out on the street, they glorify prison. Make them think they cool because they've been in. And most of the time, society only knows about prison what the TV show does.
Right.
It's way different than what the TV show does. If you're a man on the street, you got to be a man in prison.
Amen.
You know what I mean? But in the 23 years that I've done, not one day was worth any amount of money I made. I've been so close to a million that you couldn't miss a difference. But I would give all that back to have my 23 years back. You know, I was telling somebody this morning that we can't borrow tomorrow's trouble. And we can't change what happened in the past. We can only get up in the morning and live for the day. So as a young child, you got to get up every morning, and adults too, and reset yourself. You know what I mean? You got 84,400 seconds every day. That's your money that God gives you every day. You know what I mean? But I said all that to say, I came here because I love Christ and I believe in him.
Amen.
And I made it my business to make sure that I show up no matter what, no matter what I felt like I had to do. I prayed about it, and as soon as I got the invite, I told him that, you know, I'll be here. I'm trying to make it my business to at least come and support him at least once a month. You know, I'm busy with activists. He can tell you, I go across state of Mississippi speaking to people. I try to do TV interviews so I can tell kids, so I can try to stir them from doing the wrong thing. I promise you that I'm going to take one time, the first time a friend had never been in trouble. They gave me 400 months. According to man, I'm not supposed to be home.
Amen.
But according to God, I'm standing here talking.
Amen. Amen.
So if I can save one child's life, one person's life, man, I get up and I want to do that. I've had my struggles since I've been home, but I can't complain because I know one thing, that God set me free and that he'll restore me.
That's right.
You know, just like he did Job in the Bible, he'll restore me to whatever I
have. Amen.
You know, I'm not going to throw rocks back in the penitentiary. That's not an option.
Come on.
Because one night away from my wife got killed in 2004 while I was incarcerated, I lost my 31-year-old son a month and a half before I got out. I spent a lot of money paying lawyers, trying to get home, trying to get free of the system. But nothing I filed set me free. It was only God.
Come on.
It was only prayer and God. No motion I filed, no money I spent set me free. I didn't buy, as a matter of fact, I didn't buy anything. They called me last January 10th, it was on a Friday. I was having the worst day of my life in prison. I just lost my son, and every day, no parents ever have to bury their child.
Amen.
You know what I mean? Like, these kids killing each other. It's sad, it hurts me, every child that I see die. Boy, girl, black or white. Because no parents should have to bury their child.
That's right.
And so me losing my son in prison, after I spent so much time in prison, trying to ensure that neither one of them go on the path that I chose. I chose this. Nobody gave me this because I've always been a leader. I've never been a follower. So if I could go back and make that choice at that crossroad, you're going to have a choice. And the Holy Spirit is going to tell you.
Amen.
You know, whether you should do it or not. You know what I mean? And if you're throwing the rock and hiding your hand, I'm a witness. And God sees everything.
Amen.
You know what I mean? In 1996, I lost both of my best friends in 1996. Both of them got killed within 5 minutes of me leaving. I got a page. We didn't have cell phones. We had the brick cell phone, but most of us were pages. I got a page both times. And I gotta make a phone call. Both spots, within 5 minutes of me leaving, both of my best friends got killed. The last one was Friday 13th, 1996, same day Tupac died. I'm very good with numbers, I remember dates. I remember everything, good and bad. So, Thanksgiving 1996, we always have our Christmas party, the brothers and sisters there with, we would pull names and, you know, exchange gifts. All my nieces and nephews, they tell me now, man, we was all hoping that you would pull my name because they know they was going to get a good gift. You know, so, but my mom was there, and so many of my sisters and brothers needed something from me. So I ended up giving away about $13,000 that day to different family members. Me not knowing that God had been protecting me, I was riding around, never forget, I had just bought a new car, riding around my bike. And I said, Lord, I said, all my life I live for everybody else. 1997, I'm going to live for me. You know when I got arrested? 2 minutes after midnight, 1997.
Mm-hmm.
You know the first thought that came to my mind? What I said, Thanksgiving Day. I can only smile because my tongue had brought that to pass.
Amen. Definitely.
You know what I mean? It's like a whole hedge protection lifted off of me. And here I am in the system. It's, when you see your indictment, it said the United States versus Maurice Cliff. So I'm fighting the whole government. And the police actually framed me. But it was God taking me out of there saying, you want to live for yourself. You know, it wasn't until you live for yourself. Let me see how well you do.
Mm.
Now, he kept me protected and covered because of my mother's prayer.
Come on, come on. Amen.
A praying mother, man, covered her son way more.
Amen. Keep it real.
You know what I mean? So I survived in prison, but I transformed myself. I said I'm going to be better than I was when I came in. You know what I mean? And, you know, and I always told God, in your timing, if you give me the opportunity, I'll make amends. You know what I mean? I lost a lot along the way, that don't matter. I can't change that. It was in God's timing. You know what I mean? So, that Friday, like I said, I was having the worst day, man. I was walking to work. I had on a little ragged raincoat. It was pouring down rain. It was cold. In January, I was in Park City, Arkansas. I went to work that morning thinking about my son, thinking about my mom, thinking about my wife. And I was going to work. I was crying. I was listening to, I like the blues. So I was listening to David Prince. Walking to work. I went to work. And I said, I'm not going to do anything at work. And I was just praying. I was writing. You know, just thank my mom for what she had done. You know, apologize to my son. And that Friday, came back at lunch, and I called my fiance. I'm getting married December 4th this year. I called my fiance. And I told her, she was saying, you think you're going to hear anything? You know, we're always waiting to hear something from the judge. You know, the new law had just passed. And I said, it don't matter. I said, because when God says it's time, it's time.
It's time. Amen. Amen.
I was saying, if you're tired, man, I understand. You go ahead on my spirit. But it don't matter. I'm waiting on God. And new law change. I'm not gonna file anything. I'm not depending on God. But baby, we should get a lawyer. I'm not spending no money. You know, I'm away on God. Mm-hmm. So I went back to work. Still thinking, man, it was like, man, just feet were heavy, soul was tired. Mm-hmm. But I was there working, I was just thinking, another week, it's Friday. You know, we don't, if you don't hear anything about Friday, you're not gonna hear anything till Monday. You know what I mean? In the federal system. Yeah. So I was sitting at work, man, they called us, they told us we was gonna leave early. I was working in York for you know, we get off at 3:30, they told us we was gonna leave, they had an early recall. One of my former bosses came over and he said, "Hey Cliff," he said, "what you doing still here?" I said, he said, "Man, he got the word out over at the medium, at the low in the medium that you got to be released last week." I said, "Well, as you can see, I'm still here." I said, "But," I said, "it ain't 4:00. Don't give up on me yet." And I walked back to the unit. I made it to the unit about 9:45 when I got close to the unit. The guy was saying, "Man, the secretary called me. A new law had just passed to give us all a good time today." Mm-hmm. And so I said, "Well," I said, "okay," I said, "I'll go see it." And they said, "Well, the office in the processing center was calling you too." So when I went in there, SIS was in there. So they had a lot of lockers. So I'm thinking, "Oh Lord, you know, what they doing now? For investigation or anything?" So when I went, he said, the secretary wants to see you." Well, I went to the secretary's office. It was about 3:30, 4:00. She said, "I got good news and I got bad news." I said, "It's all news, just give it to me." She said, "Well, today, Mr. Clinton, you're a free man." I said, "What's the bad news?" She said, "We got to get you out of here by 4:00. I said, "Just point me the way, I'll leave." She said, "No, it's not like that. Process you out." And so here I am. It had been raining all week, all day. When I went and processed out, when I came out, when I walked out, I got ready to walk through the mother to take me and stop me. He said, "You're a free man now. You can come around." I walked around the building to take my sister was out there. When I went outside, it's like the clouds opened up and a ray of sunshine came.
Amen.
My mom shining out. The God answered her prayer.
Amen.
Not mine. My mother. I said, "All I was going to say, man, whatever you do, you got to trust God."
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.